Hello everyone and welcome back to our channel. So as you all aware, we were discussing about the nervous system. So we have covered the general electrophysiology of the nervous system. We have seen the organization of the nervous system, and we have also covered the types of cells, that is the neuroglia as well as the neurons, in detail. So we have seen the electrical signals, how the electrical signals are transmitted across the neuron. It is a structural as well as the functional unit of the nervous system. So under the organization, we have seen that the nervous system is mainly divided into two types of systems, that is the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. For the peripheral nervous system can be subdivided into autonomic nervous system, somatic nervous system, as well as the enteric nervous system. Okay, so under the central nervous system, we have seen it is composed of two portions, that is the brain and the spinal cord. So brain, which is located within the skull, it continues in the form of a cord like structure, that is called as the spinal cord. Okay, so these are the two basic components of the CNS, or the central nervous system. Okay, so we shall begin with the spinal cord in today's video. So we'll cover the basic anatomy of the spinal cord, what is the external anatomy of the spinal cord, what is the internal anatomy, how it is protected. You are all aware of the skull and the vertebral column, which mainly protects the CNS. Okay, so our skeletal system, its main function is to aid in the movement as well as protection of the internal organs. Okay, so all these internal organs, they must function appropriately. So in order to prevent any damage from the external sources, our vertebral column and the skull, it protects this CNS. Okay, likewise, the skeletal system, it protects all the vital organs which are located within the body. So vital organs are your brain, heart, lungs, kidneys, liver. Okay, so these are all your vital organs, correct? So the rib cage, it protects the lungs as well as the heart. Okay, to a certain extent the liver and the kidneys also. Okay, so all these internal organs, these are protected by the skeletal system, as well as, of course, their protective layers are also present, okay, which additionally provide the protection. So we'll be covering the protective layers of the spinal cord also. Apart from this, we shall also see how exactly the signals are being transmitted from one place to another place, which are the different types of neurons, how they travel across the body to transmit a particular signal towards the CNS and away from the CNS, and how the information is processed. Okay, so with this we shall begin with the spinal cord. So as we have already discussed in the organization, it comprises of millions of neurons, right? CNS, it comprises of billions of neurons. Okay, so the spinal cord, which is one of the part of your CNS, it comprises of nearly about 100 million neurons, and even more than that are present the neuroglia, which are the supporting cells. We have seen that the supporting cells, these are quite more in number as compared to the actual neurons, which are the functional units. Okay, so the spinal cord, it extends from the brain, as we have seen, right, from the lower portion of the brain, that is from the medulla oblongata, extends downwards the cord like structure that is called as the spinal cord. Okay, so this particular structure, it is responsible for the quick reactions which are seen. Okay, so there are certain processing of information which is carried out by the spinal cord itself. So spinal cord along with the spinal nerves which are originating from the spinal cord, they form certain neural circuits which control the rapid reactions towards certain situations, and these are called as reflexes. Say for example, you touch a hot surface. What do you do? Do you keep on thinking whether I should remove my hand or whether I should keep my hand in place? What do? You remove your hand immediately, right, from that particular hot surface. That's because of your reflex reactions which are mediated by the spinal cord. Okay, so remember the integrative function, which is one of the function of your nervous system. So this integrative function is carried out by the CNS, that is the brain and the spinal cord. So the more learned processes, these are integrated by the higher center, that is the CNS, whereas the quick reflexes, these are taken care of by the spinal cord. Okay, now coming to the spinal cord anatomy. Okay, so as I've told you earlier, we will cover the protective structures which are providing the protection against the external damage to the spinal cord. We shall discuss the internal anatomy as well as the external anatomy of the spinal cord. To begin with the protective structures, so as we have discussed in the introduction part, the nervous tissue, specifically the neurons of the CNS, they have lost their capacity to regenerate, right? So once damaged, the nerve cell cannot regenerate, especially in the central nervous system. Okay, so these are quite delicate. So it needs to be protected, as if they are injured or damaged, they will lose their function. So that's the reason why they need considerable protection. So there are two ways by which this protection can be offered to the spinal cord. One is by the bony framework, which provides the sturdy protection, and second protection which is provided by the meninges, which are the layers. There are three layers of meninges which are forming protective covering, which will help prevent any kind of shock or damage to the spinal cord. So the first layer of protection of your CNS as a whole, if you consider, it's the bony skull which protects the brain and the vertebral column. Vertebral column, it is composed of the various vertebrae which are stacked one above the other, right? So these are stacked one above the other. This particular picture shows only three vertebrae. So likewise, there are several vertebrae, the cervical vertebrae, thoracic vertebrae, lumbar vertebrae. So they stack one above the other and they surround the spinal cord. Okay, so the brain is protected by the skull and the vertebral column, it surrounds the spinal cord. Thus it protects it against any kind of damaging blows or bumps. Okay, so if you just hit your head, it won't affect your brain, right? Because it is protected by the skull. Okay, similarly, your spinal cord is also protected by the vertebral column. So bony framework is present which will protect your spinal cord. Then the second protective layer is formed by the meninges. Okay, so within the bony framework of the vertebrae lies the spinal cord. And again, surrounding the spinal cord are present three membranes. In between the bony encasement, that is your vertebrae and your spinal cord, lies the three protective layers, which will protect both the brain as well as the spinal cord. So, same three layers are protecting the brain as well as the spinal cord. As far as the location is concerned, these are called as spinal meninges, which are protecting the spinal cord, and the ones which are protecting the brain, these are known as cranial meninges. But the layers are the same, with little bit of alterations in the organization, slight modification. The three layers, the same three layers, in continuation, it is protecting the brain as well as the spinal cord. The spinal meninges are in continuation with the cranial meninges. Okay, so this is the second protective layer which is protecting the spinal cord. Apart from this, there is one more protective layer which is providing the protection to the spinal cord. That is the space in between the two meningeal membranes. It contains a fluid called as cerebrospinal fluid. So this is a buoyant liquid which suspends the central nervous system in a weightless environment. So it's a shock absorbing liquid. Okay, so it acts as a cushion, this particular fluid. So it gives an additional protection. Okay, so now there are two types of protective layers, physical layers. That is the bony framework of the vertebral column and the meninges, which are the layers which are covering the spinal cord. And the third type of protection, which is provided by the cushioning liquid, which is present in between these layers. Okay, to begin with the first type of protective layer, that is the vertebral column. Okay, so the spinal cord, it is present within the vertebral canal of the vertebral column. So as the vertebrae are stacked one above the other, this particular opening, as you can see, that's called as the vertebral foramen. You must have studied about the vertebrae in detail, right? In your HAP 1 theory as well as practical. You see, you all are all aware about the structure of the vertebrae. So it has a body, vertebral body. It has some processes. Three processes are present over here. And there is a hollow space in between, correct? And that hollow space is known as the vertebral foramen, through which the spinal cord is passing. So as a number of vertebrae are stacked one above the other, these vertebral foramen of all the vertebrae, they form a hollow canal known as the vertebral canal, through which actually the spinal cord is passing. And from the lateral opening in between the two vertebrae, there is an opening called as the intervertebral foramen. Intervertebral means between two vertebrae. Okay, so from this opening passes out the spinal nerve, which is a part of peripheral nervous system, which arises from the spinal cord. And in between two vertebrae are present the intervertebral disc, right, which protects these vertebrae from getting damaged. As they move, they should not get damaged due to the friction which is caused due to the movement of these vertebrae. So there is a protective disc which is present, that is called as the intervertebral disc. Okay, so as you can see, this is the actual picture of a vertebra with a spinal cord. This is the spinal cord and this is the vertebra. Okay, so this is your vertebral foramen through which the spinal cord is passing. Apart from these protective layers, there are vertebral ligaments, meninges, as well as the spinal cerebrospinal fluid, which is providing the additional protection to the spinal cord. Okay, so coming to the second type of protective layer, that is the meninges. Singularly, it is known as meninges, one layer. So there are three protective layers which are mainly comprised of the connective tissues. Okay, so since there are three, it is known as meninges. So these encircle the spinal cord as well as the brain. The same three layers in continuation, it is protecting the entire CNS. That is the spinal cord as well as the brain. Okay, so the ones which are surrounding the spinal cord, these are known as spinal meninges, and the ones which are surrounding the brain, these are known as cranial meninges, as I've told you. And both are in continuation, comprising of the same three layers. From superficial to deep, the layers are as follows. The outermost layer is the dura mater. This is the one. So this picture shows the three layers. Okay, they have been cut open to show the details, internal details of the three layers. Okay, so the outermost layer is the dura mater. As you can see, the spinal nerves, these are originating from the spinal cord, right? From here. So it pierces through these protective layers to join the spinal cord. Okay, so this is nothing but the axons of the neurons which are originating from the spinal cord or which are supplying towards the spinal cord. So it pierces through these three protective layers. Okay, so which are these three layers? The outermost layer is known as the dura mater. Middle layer is known as arachnoid mater, and the innermost layer is known as the pia mater. This is the one. Okay, so dura mater, middle layer is the arachnoid mater, and the innermost layer, it is the pia mater. So these are the three layers, the protective layers of the spinal cord. Okay, so these three layers are protecting the spinal nerves also, up to a point where they exit the vertebral column through the intervertebral foramen. Okay, now there are some spaces in between different layers which also are filled with some protective fluids. Okay, now the space in between the vertebra, the ball of the vertebra and the spinal cord or the outermost layer of the meninges, that space is known as the epidural space. So this particular space, epidural space, that is outside the dura mater and in between this dura mater and the vertebra, are present some protective structures called as the fats and the connective tissue. So a cushion of fat and connective tissue is present in this epidural space. So again, it will provide additional cushioning to the spinal cord, right? Now coming to the first layer, outermost layer, that is the dura mater. Actual meaning is the tough mother. So this particular layer, it has a thick, strong layer composed of dense, irregular connective tissue. So it forms a sac-like structure in which the spinal cord will be suspended. And it's continuous with the meningeal dura mater in the brain. also it is in continuation with the protective layer of the spinal and the cranial nerves, the epineurium, the outermost layer of the spinal and the cranial nerves is in continuation with this dura mater. Now the second layer is the arachnoid mater, the middle layer. Why it is known so? The actual meaning is arachn means spider and oid means similar. That's because of the spider's web-like arrangement of the collagen fibers and elastic fibers which are present. Okay, so this particular layer, it is a thin layer. Remember the dura mater, it is a thick layer. So this particular layer, it is a thin layer which is avascular, means no blood vessels are present over here. So it comprises of loosely arranged collagen and the elastic fibers mainly. And it's present deeper to the dura mater. And it is in the continuation with the arachnoid mater of the brain. Now the space in between these two layers, that is the dura mater and the arachnoid mater, that particular space is known as subdural space, this one, in between these two layers. And it is filled with the interstitial fluid. And the third layer, that is the innermost layer, is the pia mater. Pia means delicate. So this particular meninges is also a thin transparent layer of the connective tissue which adheres to the surface of the spinal cord and the brain. So it's actually in contact with the brain and the spinal cord. And mainly it is composed of squamous to cuboidal type of cells. Apart from this, the collagen fibers and elastic fibers are also present in this particular layer. And as you can see that there are blood vessels, right? Okay. So these blood vessels, they will supply the oxygen and the nutrients to the spinal cord. Now, as you can see, there is some additional structure which is located over here. These are the spinal nerves, right, which are originating from your spinal cord. But apart from this, again, there is one more structure as you can see over here. So these triangular shaped membranous extensions of the pia mater, as you can see, it is traversing through the arachnoid mater, right, over here. So these extensions, these are called as denticulate ligaments. Denticulate means small tooth. So these are actually the thickenings of the pia mater. As you can see here, these are originating from the pia mater and it is moving across towards the outer surface. So it anchors the spinal cord to all the three layers, protective layers of the meninges. Okay, so as you can see that these particular ligaments, these are placed laterally, right, in between the roots of the spinal nerves. So these structures are present on both the sides of the spinal cord, which helps keep the spinal cord protected in a particular place. Otherwise, what will happen? Due to sudden shock, there may be displacement of the spinal cord. So that is prevented by this particular structure, denticulate ligament. Remember, what is the job of the ligaments? They hold the internal organs in place, right? So it keeps a particular organ in a particular area, right? Otherwise, what will happen? The internal organs will move about within the body, right? Does it happen? Each organ has its own place, right? So that's because of all these ligaments. Okay, so they again serve as a protective function by preventing the sudden displacement of the spinal cord. So they will prevent it against any kind of external damage. Then there is one more space which is present in between these two layers, the arachnoid mater and the pia mater. That particular space is known as subarachnoid space, and that is filled with the cerebrospinal fluid. Remember this space between the dura and the arachnoid matter? It is known as subdural space and it is filled with the interstitial fluid. Whereas the space between the arachnoid matter and the pia mater, it is called as the subarachnoid space, and that is filled with the shock absorbing liquid known as the cerebrospinal fluid. So this to do with the protective layers of the spinal cord. Now coming to the external anatomy of the spinal cord. Now roughly the spinal cord, it has an oval shape. If you take a cross section of the spinal cord, it is roughly oval in shape and flattened anteriorly and posteriorly. Anteriorly meaning in front, posterior means towards the back side. So it's a little bit flattened in the front side and the back side, and towards the lateral side on the either sides it is bulging. So it's oval shape, and in adults it extends from the lower portions of the medulla oblongata, that is the inferior part of the brain, to the superior border of the second lumbar vertebrae. As you can see here, these are the vertebrae. Okay, this one. And these are the thoracic vertebrae, 12 thoracic vertebrae, right? And there are 5 lumbar vertebrae. These are the ones located in the trunk. And the last part contains the fused bones, fused vertebrae, sacrum and the coccyx. Sacrum consists of the 5 fused bones. Coccyx comprises of the 4 fused bones, right? It's rudimental in structure. Okay, so the spinal cord, it extends from the medulla oblongata, which is the lower portion of the brain, up to the second lumbar vertebrae, somewhere around here. Okay, this region. Now, as you can see, the spinal cord is even shorter than the vertebral column, right? Your vertebral column extends round up to this particular area, right? Now, why it is so? Have you ever thought why the spinal cord does not extend up to the end of the vertebral column? Of course, there are vertebral column which is extended up to this particular portion, right? But the spinal cord, it ends over here. Have you thought of why it must be like that? That's because of the differential growth. Now, in the newborns, actually the spinal cord, it extends up to third or fourth lumbar vertebrae. It's even longer as compared to the adults as far as the size of the vertebral column is concerned, not the actual length. So extension into the vertebral column, if you compare, it's longer in the infants. And during early childhood, both the spinal cord as well as the vertebral column will be growing. Correct? But the elongation of the spinal cord, it stops around the age of 4 to 5 years. But the growth of vertebral column, it continues. That is the reason why the spinal cord does not extend throughout the vertebral column. Because its growth has stopped around the age of 4 to 5 years. Okay. Now in adults, the length of the spinal cord ranges from 42 to 45 centimeters and the diameter is round about 2 centimeters in the mid thoracic region, and it may be somewhat larger in these two regions, the cervical region and in the lumbar region. Okay, now as you can see that there are two enlargements right over here. The spinal cord, if you consider the entire length of the spinal cord, specifically in these two regions, it is enlarged slightly, right? Now these enlargements, these two enlargements, these are called as cervical enlargement and the lumbar enlargement, depending upon its location. As you can see, this particular region, it's located within the cervical vertebrae, right? So it's called as a cervical enlargement. So this extends from the fourth cervical vertebra somewhere over here up to the first thoracic vertebra, and this second inferior enlargement is present in the lumbar region. So it extends from the ninth thoracic vertebra to the 12th thoracic vertebra. That's called as the lumbar enlargement. Okay, so nerves which are originating and supplying to this particular region, cervical enlargement, they are supplying the upper limbs. Whereas the nerves which are supplying to and originating from this lumbar enlargement, these are actually supplying the lower limbs. Now, inferior to this lumbar enlargement, the spinal cord, it terminates in the form of a cone-like structure, right? V-shaped, you can see. So, three-dimensional structure, if you consider, it is tapering at the end, conical in structure, and that particular portion is known as conus medullaris. Conus means cone, so it's cone-shaped, that's why it is known as conus medullaris. So this will end somewhere in between the first and the second lumbar vertebrae, intervertebral disc which is present in between these two lumbar vertebrae, first and the second. And arising from the tip of this conus medullaris is the phylum terminal, means terminal filament. So as you can see, a small thread-like structure which is originating from the tip and it extends round up to the coccyx. This is the phylum terminal. So it's actually originating at the tip of this conus medullaris, that is at the tip of the spinal cord, and it is anchoring the spinal cord to the coccyx, which is the last part of your vertebral column. Okay, now originating from your spinal cord are a number of spinal nerves, right? As you can see, these names which are given over here, C1, C2, C3, C4 and so on, T1, T2, C means cervical, T means thoracic, L means lumbar, S means the sacral. Okay, and there is a coccygeal nerve also. So there are 31 pairs of these spinal nerves which are originating from the spinal cord, which may receive the sensory input and they are giving out the motor output to the effectors. Okay, so these form the part of the peripheral nervous system actually. Spinal nerves. Okay, so this serves as a pathway for communication between the central nervous system and rest of the body. So as you can see that these are formed in the pairs, right? So from the either side of the spinal cord, the nerve will be originating, right? So this is the first spinal nerve, that is known as the C1. So it's originating on either sides, right? So likewise, there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves which are emerging from the spinal cord at a regular interval. So you can see that the spinal cord may be divided into several segments. Now, actually, there is no anatomical segmentation of the spinal cord. It's in continuation. But for convenience, this particular spinal cord may be considered to be divided into several segments from which these different types of nerves are originated. Okay, so these can be divided into several types based on from which area they are exactly originating. So there are 8 pairs of cervical nerves, C1 to C8, these are called as cervical nerves. There are 12 pairs of thoracic nerves, these are the ones, T1 to T12. There are 5 pairs of lumbar nerves, L1 to L5, these are the ones. As you can see, these are originating from the lumbar region. There are five pairs of sacral nerves S1 to S5 which are originating from the sacral region, and there is one pair of Caucasian nerve, this one, last one. Okay, so these are Caucasian nerve, only one pair is present. Okay, so these are the 31 pairs of the spinal nerves which are either receiving the signals from the periphery and providing the signals, the output to the periphery for the necessary action. Now, there are two bundles of axons which are known as the roots, which connect each spinal nerve to the segment of the spinal cord. As you can see, it's not a single structure which is connecting with the spinal cord. This is a section of the spinal cord, one particular segment you can consider. So as you can see that the spinal nerve, this is the one which is actually originating from the spinal cord. But as you can see that there are two bundles which are actually connecting the spinal cord, right? And these are called as the roots. Roots. And further, as it moves closer to the spinal cord, it is even subdivided into smaller bundles of axons, and these are called as the rootlets. Okay, now the posterior root, as you can see this one, this is the anterior side of the spinal cord, and that's the posterior side. The front side, this is the back side. So the posterior root, as you can see, which is joining the spinal cord posteriorly, that is called as the posterior root. Or the posterior side is also called as a dorsal, right? And the anterior side, it is also known as ventral side. So the posterior root or the dorsal root, as it is called as, and the posterior rootlets or the dorsal rootlets, they contain only the sensory axons. As you can see over here, this blue colored neuron, it's actually a sensory neuron. Okay, nerve impulse, it is entering the spinal cord through this posterior. So any impulse from the sensory receptor, may it be from the skin, muscle or some internal organ, so it is conveyed to the CNS through these spinal nerves. So this particular signal will enter the spinal cord through this posterior root. There are two on either sides. So it contains the axons of the sensory neurons. So in this posterior root is present the posterior root ganglion. This is the one. So both the sides of the spinal cord, they will have a posterior root ganglion. Remember, what is a ganglion? Ganglion, it is a term which is given for a collection of cell bodies. Correct? And a collection of cell bodies in the periphery, it is called as the ganglia. Whereas a collection of the cell bodies in the CNS, that is called as, can you recall? It is called as nucleus. Okay, so this posterior root on either sides, it contains a slight swelling, right? It's ganglion, the meaning of ganglion itself is swelling. So this particular structure, it contains the cell bodies of the sensory neurons. Okay, so the cell bodies of all the sensory neurons which are arriving at this place are present in this particular region. That's why it is slightly swollen in nature, and that's called as the posterior or the dorsal root ganglion. Apart from this is present the anterior root and the rootlets. These are the ones. This is the anterior roots and these are the anterior rootlets on either sides. So this anterior root, it actually contains the axons of motor neurons which are supplying to some effector organ, say muscles or glands. So whatever information is processed by your CNS, it is sending some output in the form of motor neurons and they exit the spinal cord through this anterior root, rootlets and roots. So ultimately it will join with the spinal nerve. Spinal nerve is actually a mixed nerve. It contains these sensory neurons as well as the motor neurons. So entry and the exit point is the same. That is the spinal nerve. But the entry and exit into the spinal cord is not the same. The entry, that is the sensory neurons, they enter the spinal cord through the posterior root. Whereas the motor neurons, they exit the spinal cord through the anterior root. So as these spinal nerves branch from the spinal cord, they pass laterally and they exit the vertebral column through this intervertebral foramen on either sides of the vertebral column. However, what did I tell you about the length of the spinal cord? Does it extend throughout the vertebral column? No, it doesn't. But as you can see, the nerves, they are exiting this the vertebral column at different levels, right? Whereas the spinal cord ends over here, still there are nerves which are coming out from these regions, lower regions, right? Now that's because the spinal nerves which are originating from these lower levels of the spinal cord, these actually move downwards and then they exit at their respective levels. As you can see, all these, almost all the lumbar vertebrae, they also exit a particular nerve, spinal nerve, right? Lumbar nerves. There are sacral nerves also and there are coccygeal nerves also. So these nerves which are actually originating from the spinal cord, they do not exit the vertebral column at the same level at which they originate. They originate somewhere over here, but they extend downwards inferiorly along the phylum terminale. Remember, phylum terminale, which is originating from the tip of the conus medullaris, and it extends down up to coccyx. So these nerves which are originating over here, they travel along this phylum terminale and then they exit the vertebral column at different levels. So these nerves, they will have an appearance of the wisp of hair. Have you ever seen a horse's tail? How it looks like? It has a number of wisps, right? So this particular structure which contains the different spinal nerves, it gives a similar appearance, right? Just like a horse's tail. That's why this particular structure, arrangement of these spinal nerves, it is called as cauda equina. Collectively, all these nerves, these are called as cauda equina. Then coming to the internal anatomy of the spinal cord. So far we have seen the external anatomy of the spinal cord, now coming to the internal anatomy. Now transverse section of the spinal cord, this will reveal that there are differential areas which are present of the grey matter and the white matter. Remember the grey matter and the white matter which we had discussed earlier in the introduction? White matter generally comprises of the myelinated axons, whereas a grey matter usually comprises of the unmyelinated neurons and the cell bodies and the neuroglia. Okay, so as you can see that some portion is whitish in color and some regions of the spinal cord appear grayish in color. Okay, so that's because of the differential arrangement of the myelinated, unmyelinated axons and the cell bodies. Apart from this, there are two grooves which are present, right? One towards the anterior surface and the second one towards the posterior surface. As you can see, this groove which is located on the anterior surface, it is actually wider in nature. And this groove is known as anterior median fissure. And the one which is located posteriorly, that groove is quite narrow, right? The one which is located posteriorly, and that is called as posterior median sulcus. This is the one, this groove. Okay, now the gray matter, coming to the gray matter, arrangement of the gray matter. Just focus on this structure. So as you can see that this particular gray matter, it is shaped like letter H, right? Can you imagine this one? Or say it looks like a butterfly, if you can imagine. Okay, so this gray matter generally comprises of the cell bodies and the dendrites of the neurons and the unmyelinated axons and the neuroglia. That's why it has a grayish appearance. Remember, the nissl bodies, they give this grayish appearance usually. And the crossbar of the edge, this one, this particular region, it is known as the gray commissure. Now, at the center of this gray commissure is present the central canal. That is a small space which is extending throughout the spinal cord, and that is known as central canal. And it is filled with the cerebrospinal fluid. So it is in continuation with the fourth ventricle of your brain, that is in the medulla oblongata. Then, anterior to this gray commissure, this is the gray commissure, right? The crossbar of the H. Now, anterior to this gray matter is located the anterior white commissure, this one. Anterior white commissure. This is the gray commissure. Anterior to this is placed the anterior white commissure, or it is also known as ventral white commissure because it is located in the front side. So this will connect the white matter of the right hand side and the left hand side of the spinal cord. As you can see that these two grooves have divided your spinal cord into two halves. So the white matter on both the sides, it is joined by this anterior white commissure. Now in the gray matter of the spinal cord and the brain, the clusters of cell bodies are present, right? So these are called as the nuclei, as we have seen. So the cell bodies in the periphery, they are called as ganglion, and the cell bodies in the CNS, when they are grouped together, these are called as nuclei. So there are nuclei, several nuclei which are located in this gray matter. So the sensory nuclei, they will receive the input from the sensory neuron, whereas the motor nuclei which are present, they will give the output towards the motor neuron. Now this gray matter on each side of the spinal cord, as you can see, it is divided into certain regions called as horns. Now there are three types of horns based on its location. Okay, the ones which are located posterior, as you can see here, horn-like structure, correct? So the ones which are located on the posterior side, these are called as posterior gray horns, or the posterior, or the dorsal gray horn, because they are located towards the posterior side. So they contains mainly the cell bodies and axons of the interneurons as well as the sensory neurons. And the cell bodies of the sensory neurons are mainly located in the posterior root ganglion actually. Whereas in the posterior gray horn here are located the cell bodies of the interneurons. Similarly, in the anterior region lies the anterior gray horn. These are the ones on either side, or these are also known as ventral gray horn. So they mainly contain the somatic motor nuclei. So these are the clusters of cell bodies of the somatic motor neuron, cell bodies of the somatic motor neurons, which will supply to certain effector organs. Say for example, the skeletal muscles. So they provide the output to the contraction of the skeletal muscle. Now, in between this posterior and the anterior gray horn lies the lateral horn. This is the one. That's the lateral horn on either side. So this mainly contains the autonomic motor nuclei. So what are the autonomic motor nuclei? These are the ones which are containing the cell bodies of the autonomic motor neurons, which are actually supplying the cardiac muscles, smooth muscles and the glands. So they are part of the autonomic nervous system. So autonomic nervous system, which sends the signals to the organs like the heart or the visceral organs or the glands for controlling the movements and the secretions or the contractions of the muscles. Now, just like your gray matter is organized in specific areas, we have seen that there is gray commissure, then there are horns, posterior horns, anterior horns and the lateral horns, which comprises of the cell bodies. So similarly, the white matter of the spinal cord is also organized into different regions. Okay, so the anterior and the posterior horns of the gray matter, it divides the white matter on each side into three broad areas. Anterior white columns, this is the one, anterior white column on either side. Posterior white column or the dorsal white column, these are the ones. Anterolateral white columns, these are the ones on either sides, lateral white columns. Okay, so each of this column, it has distinct bundle of axons. Remember, what is a white matter? It is the myelinated axons, right, which make up the white matter. So there will be a number of axons which are running through this particular white matter. So these bundles of axons, what they are called in the CNS? They are called as tracts. Remember, the bundles of axons in the periphery, these are known as spinal nerves. And the bundles of axons in the CNS, they are called as tracts. So they will carry this signal along the spinal cord to communicate with the brain. Okay, so there are two types of tracts, the sensory tracts, or these are known as ascending tracts. So they will move in the upward direction towards the brain. So it will carry the nerve impulse towards the brain for processing. And the tracts known as the motor tracts or the descending tracts, they will travel downwards along the spinal cord to give the output from the brain. So these are in continuation with the sensory and the motor tracts in the brain. So if they will supply in appropriate region, the information will be integrated and the output will be sent in the form of motor tracts, which will join the motor tracts of the spinal cord, and ultimately it will exit out and give the output. Okay, so this is to do with the internal anatomy of the spinal cord. Now this internal organization of the spinal cord, why it is so? Why the arrangement is in this particular fashion? That's because it has to carry out several functions. That is, either the information which is brought in, it needs to be processed, or it needs to be sent towards the brain. So the spinal cord, it acts as mainly the pathway to carry the signal towards the brain, which have been brought from several areas of the body through several spinal nerves, which are supplying to a particular area and bringing the signal from a particular area. So this particular internal organization, it serves to carry out the transmission of information and processing of that information. So this particular information, it can be processed in a number of ways, or a number of steps are involved in that. The first step will be to detect some kind of alterations, right? So some change which will be detected by the sensory receptors. So if it has a stimulus, that particular sensory stimulus, it will activate the sensory receptors which are located in several areas of the body. So this is one of the example which is given over here, sensory receptors in the skin. Likewise, there are a number of sensory receptors throughout the body which are monitoring the internal as well as external environment. Because the first step is to sense some alteration, some stimulus. It will be carried towards your CNS, right, for processing. Because the decision cannot be taken at this particular level. So it needs to be taken towards your CNS. Okay, so this sensory neuron, it will convey this sensory input, which is sensed by the sensory receptors in the form of a nerve impulse, and it will be carried towards the spinal cord. As you can see, this one, this neuron, so it is extending from the sensory receptors, it is traveling through the spinal nerve and then into the posterior root. That's a posterior root, right? Posterior root, and that's a posterior root ganglion. So here the cell bodies of this sensory neuron will be present. Okay, so from this posterior root, the axons of the sensory neurons may proceed in three different ways now. Now, what is the first possibility? The axons of this sensory neuron, it may extend into the white matter and it will ascend towards the brain in the form of a sensory tract, or the ascending tract as it is known as. Okay, so this is one possibility. What is the second possibility? The axons of this sensory neuron, it may enter the posterior gray horn. That's a posterior gray horn, right? This one and this one. So it may enter this posterior gray horn, synapse with an interneuron. So here there is a formation of the synapse. These are axon terminals, and that's the cell body of the next neuron. That's an interneuron. So what is the function of this interneuron? This in turn will carry the same signal further, right? So it may extend into the white matter and then it will ascend in the form of sensory tract, and the information will be carried towards the brain. So in the first case, directly the sensory neurons were entering into the white matter and was ascending towards the brain. In the second case, it may synapse with an interneuron, and that in turn will enter the gray matter. From here it will go to the white matter, then it is going towards the brain. And the third possibility is that it may enter the gray matter via the posterior gray horn, synapse with an interneuron, and this interneuron in turn is synapsing with a somatic motor neuron. So what is the difference over here in between this one and this one? What is happening over here? This interneuron, it is processing the information which is brought by this sensory neuron, and it is sending the output itself. So what has happened? The integrative function is being carried out by the spinal cord. So what it is known as? That is known as the reflex pathway. So here the impulses are not carried towards your brain, but the impulses are processed at the spinal level. Okay, so these are the three possibilities which will happen with the sensory information which has been brought by the sensory neuron. Either it will enter the white matter, ascend towards the brain, it will enter the gray matter via posterior horn, gray horn, synapse with the interneuron, which in turn will enter the white matter, take it towards the brain. Third possibility is it will synapse with the interneuron within the gray matter of the spinal cord, which will in turn synapse with a motor neuron, somatic motor neuron. So this motor output from the spinal cord towards the skeletal muscle, this actually involves the somatic motor neurons. As you can see, the interneuron is synapsing with the somatic motor neuron, this one. That's a motor neuron. What is the function of motor neuron? It takes the signals away from the central nervous system in the form of an output. So depending upon what input was brought from by these sensory receptors, an appropriate output is given by the spinal cord. That means it's a reflex. Say for example, if you touch a hot surface, these receptors immediately will send a signal to the spinal cord. Spinal cord, instead of sending it to the brain, it will process it at the spinal level. It will synapse with a motor neuron and send the signal immediately for appropriate action. So skeletal muscles in your hand will contract and will withdraw your hand. Okay. Now in turn, many of these somatic motor neurons may be also regulated by the brain, right? The signal may also be given by the higher center. Supposing if the sensory information is carried towards the brain, obviously the output will be given by the brain, right? So it will be coming in the form of motor tracks, descending tracks into this white matter of the spinal cord. And here it will in turn synapse with the somatic motor neuron, either directly or indirectly. And further the signal will be carried towards the effector. Now when this activated somatic motor neuron, it conveys the motor output, it will pass through this anterior gray horn, through the anterior root, and then it will enter into the spinal nerve. And from spinal nerve, the axons of this somatic motor neurons will extend up to the skeletal muscles of the body to convey the signal, which is either processed over here or which is processed by the brain. Okay, now there may be motor output from the spinal cord also to the cardiac muscles or the smooth muscles or the glands. Now these are not under your control, right? So that's an autonomic motor neuron which is originating from the lateral gray horn. Remember, it contains the nuclei for the autonomic motor neurons, so it gives the signal. So when this autonomic motor neuron, it is activated, it will give the motor output to the organs like your heart or some visceral organs or some glands. So this will be given out in the form of an output which will travel along this particular anterior gray horn. So it will enter into the anterior root and then it will enter into the spinal nerve. So from spinal nerve, the axons of this autonomic motor neurons, they will synapse with another neuron. So same neuron might not supply to the organs, but it will synapse over here in the periphery with the autonomic motor neurons, and this in turn will carry the information towards the different organs where it is supplying, say the heart or some internal organs, say for example the urinary bladder or certain glands. Okay, so this is how the information is conveyed towards the CNS, processed in the CNS, and the appropriate output is given. So these are the different ways by which the signal can be transmitted towards and away from the CNS for appropriate action. Okay, so we have covered the protective layers of the spinal cord, which is a part of the central nervous system. So the protective layers, the external anatomy, the internal anatomy of the spinal cord, and the internal organization which help in conveying the and processing the information. So we have seen the different pathways by which the information can be conveyed towards and away from the CNS. Thank you for watching.